Our D&D Curse of Strahd campaign continues. The party is made up of Krusk, the Half-Orc Paladin, Gouda, our wild magic sorcerer with her familiar bird snacks, Garo, our cleric-monk combo, who now looks like a plant because he died in the last episode and a dryad ghost lady brought him back to life, and Boshack, our lizardfolk warlock who, I forgot to mention in the last video, but Boshack is disabled with only one arm because of backstory. In the previous session, our heroes come to the lands of Barovia, lured by a forged letter written by Strahd von Zarovich, the vampire lord. We are now his prisoners in his lands. The valley is surrounded by mists that prevent people from leaving. We're there to kill him, I think? We're supposed to be there to bring peace to Barovia and end the curse of the land, so that seems like the best way to do it. Irina has been bitten by Strahd, who is obsessed with a woman and trying to kidnap her. We flee from the village and are heading to Vallaki, a town which resents Strahd and where we know she'll be safe. Another side quest, we are also trying to keep our eyes open for Gertruda, a missing child. Apparently she's been abducted and there's a grieving woman who's looking for her. The last place she was seen was at the windmill. We continue traveling across the gothic, haunting lands of Barovia, surrounded by withering trees and looming clouds overhead. While the party is crossing a bridge, on either side, a pack of wolves ambush the group and come charging towards us.
Servants of Strahd!
Irina says, drawing her blade. The group manages to fend the wolves off. Turns out the shatter spell is really good at low levels and can kill like 6 of them in one blow. But as we're fighting, we notice that one of the wolves is hardier than the others, our attacks glancing off of him. Once the pack gets thinned, the wolves turn tail and flee, vanishing into the forest. Gouda was nuzzling her bird, going,
"They almost tried to eat snacks!"
I, as the cleric, start doing my normal cleric business.
Cure wounds! I got your cure wounds right here! Just step on up for your fresh, hot cure wounds!
But I notice that Ismark's clothes are spotted with blood. It looks like he was bitten. Oh no. One of the wolves was resisting against our normal attacks. He was probably only weak to silver.
Which means if Ismark was bitten, Krusk said, he's a werewolf now. And no one's gotten removed curse?
Well, it should be fine. Until night, I said. We still got a job to do, but yeah, he's a goner. We continue our journey, running across a carriage. A woman calls out to us,
"Hello there! New faces! I don't see new faces all that often!"
"That's Anastasia,"
Irina informs us,
"Bride of Strahd."
"Oh, I see you've been bitten by one of my doggies,"
Anastasia says, giggling and noticing Ismark's wound.
"Looks like I'm going to be adding a new pop to my collection."
"Your dogs?"
"Why, yes, all of the packs work under me."
"Do you think we could take her? Like, beat the shit out of her? If she's a fucking vampire, I don't think so. We're like third level. She's probably like 15 or some shit. Besides, she's got other people with her."
"Oh my, you must be Irina."
She starts glaring daggers at her.
"Strahd's been talking a lot about you. An awful lot."
Garo told the group,
"Why don't we just start backing away?
There's no need to be frightened, dear. We're just having a chat right now."
As she blows a kiss in your direction, Garo, roll a wisdom save. That's an 8.
"You know what? I think we got off on the wrong foot. She's really nice."
She giggles as the carriage closes up. Her servant lashes the horse, and the carriage continues forward.
"Take care, dears. Everything happens for a reason. Your guests in my husband's home. Do try not to get into too much trouble."
"Goodbye. Goodbye. Look forward to seeing you again." "How long does the vampire's charm affect this before it wears off?"
24 hours.
24 hours! "That's great. Wow. It's all just fucking great, isn't it?"
After that encounter, the group continues traveling along the road. You notice that there is a windmill. Immediately, the dog Lancelot starts running towards it. Gouda can tell the dog is saying, "Gertruda! Gertruda!"
"What's up with that?"
"Oh yes," Boshack said. "The dog is from the missing girl, Gertruda. The last place he saw her was at the windmill. He thinks this is the place."
Yeah, we gotta get to the bottom of this, so we'll split the group up here. Ismark and Irina will wait farther down the road. Gouda and Krusk can wait nearby, and Boshack and I will go inside to check it out. We knock on the door.
"Yes, how can I help you?"
You notice there are two women inside. You smell the wonderful scent of pastries.
Oh, hello. Welcome. Please come in. Always looking for new business.
We enter. Oh yeah, you guys made the dream pastries. Those were quite amazing. We had wonderful dreams.
It's wonderful that you liked our little bakery. Morgantha is the one who sells them.
Garo leans into Boshack and whispers,
I'm gonna go find the missing girl.
Lancelot and I sneak upstairs while Boshack is downstairs talking. Upstairs we find a girl, sleeping on a cot. The dog Lancelot leaps into her, licking her face excitedly.
What?
She says, shocked that the dog was there. Are you Gertruda?
No, I'm Ophelia,
she says. That's weird, because this dog seems to think you're Gertruda.
Well...
She looks around cautiously.
I was Gertruda, but now I'm Ophelia.
What? She looks around once more, kind of leans in and whispers.
They're holding me captive. They're forcing me to call myself Ophelia.
Why?
I don't know. They say it's time for me to be a part of their family.
Oh, no. I think I know where this is going.
Downstairs, Boshack is talking with the other two women.
In order for us to make the dream pastries, we need to fill them with dreams.
Where exactly do you get the dreams from?
Oh, all you really need is just one live child for the batch.
You hear retching sounds coming from Garo upstairs.
Oh, well, that's fine then,
Boshack says, unfazed.
What do you mean that's fine? Boshak's chaotic evil. He eats people as well.
Oh, great. Am I the only good-aligned character in this building? Whatever, we aren't having this conversation right now, because I'm one floor up from you just overhearing this talk.
We receive our recipes from Lord Dendar, giver of secret truths to all his followers.
You worship Dendar as well?
Boshack points to himself and says,
I too am a follower of him. I did not expect to find another one here.
You too as well? Well, how convenient is that?
Boshack, I said, seriously, you're doing this to me right now?
I said I was a warlock that worshipped a dark master. You never asked what dark master that was.
Oh, great. Guess everyone's just a big old happy family down there. Fine, whatever. We're not in the same room. We're not having this talk.
My familiar is named after my favorite food to eat.
He shows them his imp familiar, which becomes visible.
Say hi to Femur. But might I ask, why children? Have you tried making them with adults?
They just don't make dreams the way children's do. Little children. Kids are so full of hope, and as they get older, it gets crushed out of them by life. They don't make the best pastries. But what about you? What secrets and recipes has Dendar shared with you?
Downstairs, the three are having a pleasant conversation about Dendar. Upstairs, I'm rummaging around. Garo, you hear from the attic a banging and a muffled,
Help!
Oh, no. The DM asks Garo, Do you want to go upstairs?
Do I?
Why would I go up when I already know what I'm going to find? Yes. In the attic, you see several crates nailed shut. You take out the nails and undo them, and two kids come tumbling out. Don't worry, I'm a cleric. I'm here to help you guys. I'm gonna get you out of here.
How? It's cold. Where's my mammy?
You know what, Timmy? I don't want to hear you back-talking me, and I don't appreciate your negative attitude. How am I gonna get you out of here? Out in front, rolling a cart up, is Morgantha, empty from selling pastries. She enters as well.
Crap, I don't think I can make it downstairs.
Wait, we're on the third floor. I'll tie a rope. We'll climb down and make a break for it.
It's risky. I think the kids can do it, but not a whole lot of options right now.
I'll go first and you guys follow after me. We'll slip past them like a ghost on the wind, a shadow in the night, and they'll be none the wiser.
All right, Garo, give me a stealth check. Boshack, downstairs you're still talking to the three women, and all of a sudden... They get interrupted when there's a loud bang.
Pow! Cocksucking Christ! Fuck. I don't think they heard that.
To suddenly see Garo swinging down from the window. He hasn't noticed the rest of the group yet.
What is your friend doing out there?
I think he is trying to rescue the children you have upstairs.
You see Garo fall from the rope onto his back.
Ah, fuck!
Is your friend an idiot?
Yes. Yes, he is.
Ah, well, I guess we'll have to stop him.
Apologies for him inconveniencing you.
They come around outside to see Garo trying to help and get the kids to safety.
Now, now, now. That's enough of that. Don't think you can get away so easily.
Oh, get away. Is that what you think we're doing here? I was just trying to get downstairs, and this is the fastest way to get to the downstairs.
She looks up to the top floor to see the other kids nervously looking out the window. She doesn't seem to believe you.
Eat sacred flame to the face, bitch!
Garo says, and I throw a spell at her. A fight breaks out. All right, I just gotta tell you guys now, Garo is not leaving here without those kids. I might die, but I'm getting them out of here. The elderly woman drops her appearance. She reveals her long claws, sharp teeth, and ragged white hair. You know she's a hag. Yeah, that makes sense. Three women living in a coven. Of course they'd be hags. Eh, they're tough, but they're probably takeable. As long as she's not a night hag, we should be able to win. She's a night hag. Well, this changes things. Oh yeah, night hags, dream pastries. That all makes sense. Very nice thematically tied. Calling out, the other two party members rush over to help. Krusk and Gouda join into the fray, running from the woods. You guys, get the kids out of here. I'll hold them off. They cast Lightning Bolt, instantly downing Garo, as he suddenly takes a colossal amount of damage. Okay. Well then, guess I wasn't able to fulfill my promise to those dryads. As a player, I reach into my bag and pull out my backup character sheet. Time for my next character. Stan Velsing, vampire and werewolf hunter extraordinaire, was walking by the windmill when all of a sudden he heard a lightning bolt. What was that? He says. Stop, Ben, stop. You're not dead yet. Oh, I guess Stan Velsing heard the sound and was like, eh, it's probably nothing, and kept walking. After me, the hags managed to down Krusk in one round.
I could have taken them, Krusk said, if I had just one more turn.
What are you going to do? I said, what was your ace in the hole?
I can lay on hands. I can undo anything they throw at me.
That's not how that works. You do it once, and then you just throw another lightning bolt. Krusk was horrified.
They can do it more than once?
Yeah, and if that doesn't work, they can just claw you to death with their bare hands. Then the hags cast sleep on the other two. In two rounds, they managed to down and capture the entire party.
Me as well,
Boshack asks.
Sorry, dearie, but we can't have you getting into any more trouble.
The group wakes up, all of us tied up, inside the windmill. You've been healed up, so you aren't dead. We're still alive?
For now,
Morgantha says.
Now down to business. We need your help for a little job of ours. We have a problem. We need to get our pastries into Vallaki, but the problem is that we're not allowed in there. But if you take the pastries in for us and distribute them, that will be fine.
Okay, I guess we'll do it. We don't really have a lot of options right now.
Also, if you happen to come across any unwanted children, please let us know. We sure could use them here.
Yeah, we'll keep our eyes out for them, and if we see them, you're the first person we're talking to.
I'm thinking to myself, all I have to just say is, hey, we didn't find them, then that'll be easy.
Really, when you think about it, these hags aren't so bad. What you have here is a small upstart business, working hard, using their own capital, enterprising individuals, really. They're even looking to develop into new, untapped markets.
But they're still thinking too small. Really, the key here is franchising. I can envision having windmills set up all across the countryside, taking kids in and...
Man, this shit got dark. I'm backing out of this joke.
Splendid. It looks like you are reasonable after all.
She holds up several vials and takes a sample of our blood.
We'll be keeping an eye on you. And also, you must give over something of yours that's valuable. Either your last breath, your victory, your memory, or your silver tongue.
My what?
Either your last breath, your victory, your memory, or your silver tongue.
I guess my last breath.
Both Garo and Krusk gave up the same thing. The DM explained, they make you breathe into a jar and give it to them. You now only have 2 death fails, not 3.
Ah!
Gouda looks up at them, eyes full of contempt, and goes,
ew.
Now, 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 we can't have that attitude, can we? guess you still haven't learned yet. I need to educate you.
The Night Hag takes one of her clawed hands, leans forward in towards our little gnome warlock Gouda, and slashes her throat out.
Oh no, not Gouda!
There's a splurt of blood that issues out from her as her head rolls back and her body falls to the floor, dead before she hits the ground.
Why not me?
Garo said.
You're still useful to us, I'm afraid.
They kick her body off to the side. The rest of the players are just looking at the corpse, horrified.
Now, does all that sound good to you? Or are we going to have another problem?
Horrified, Garo leans up and says, You won't be hearing any trouble from me. I apologize. I am a stranger to these lands. I'm starting to understand a little bit of how you do things in Barovia, the way that this place works, and what is to be expected of me.
Looks like you learn quick.
We cut to later. Ismark and Irina are waiting down the road. They notice our group approaching them.
How was it? Did it go?
Ismark's voice trails off. In my arms, covered in blood, is the body of Gouda.
What happened?
I failed her. And she's dead because of me. I walk out the road towards the bushes and set her down, preparing to give her last rites and bury the body, when her eyes suddenly flicker open and she takes a deep breath in.
Gouda, you're okay?
Well, I think so,
she says, standing up.
I met a new friend, kind of like your dryad girlfriend you met earlier.
She's not my girlfriend.
Sections of skin on her arms opened up, revealing underneath them other sets of eyes. Her body now has multiple small eyes all over it.
Ah!
Gouda, this is your gift. You now have extra eyes and can use those eyes to cast from them. You can cast some cantrips from them. One is Ray of Frost, one is Firebolt, another is Acid Splash, similar to that. Welp, guess Gouda met a beholder. Also, your familiar is different as well. Instead of being your normal tiny bird, what flies around you excitedly is a gazer. A small floating head with a few eye stalks coming out of it. Kind of like a beholder, but a lot smaller and much weaker. But Snax is still your little burp. His personality hasn't changed. The one thing I don't get about the last fight was, why wasn't Gertruda, the last kidnapped child, also in the crates? They seem to be taking better care of her than the others. Boshack pointed out,
Hags need to have three sisters to be part of a coven. When one dies, they have to replace them. What you have to understand is that when a child is young, they will take a kid and replace them with one of their own. Once the child matures, they will transform and become a fully grown hag.
Meaning that odds are if they're talking about adding Gertruda to their family, she's long gone. She's a hag. Next time we come across her, we're probably going to have to kill her. I'd like to point out that all we've done so far today is just travel along a road, and we got jumped by werewolves, met Strahd's bride, lost to some hags, and had one of our PCs murdered. We're not doing so hot. Farther up the road, we run into an NPC, Vasily, a noble from Vallaki. We save him and he promises to be our guide in town, showing us where everything is. As we reach the gates, Ismark unfortunately had been bitten by the werewolf. He couldn't enter the city. Because of his curse, he would be a threat. Boshack makes him an offer.
If you want it, I can kill you in the forest. That way you won't be able to harm anyone.
Boshack, make a persuasion roll. Garo's like, not happy about this.
Boshack, you better screw this roll up, because we don't want to have to kill this dude.
18 persuasion. Ismark winces. He thinks about it and says,
I think I'll take my chances in the wilderness. Maybe I'll come across a cure, a way to fix it sometime. Who knows? I have hope.
Boshack, you needed a 20 for him to be okay with that.
Well, the offer is still open if you ever need it.
Thanks.
I would also like to eat your organs if that can be arranged. I'm calling dibs right now. Don't want to be having to fight with the other players for feeding rights, now do we?
We split off from him. He wandered into the forest, disappearing into the woods, and we went inside to Vallaki with Irina. Now that we have arrived, we get a chance to explore. From talking around town, what we discover is that this town is very anti-Strahd. So much so that it is a criminal offense to say his name. Everyone can only refer to him as the Devil. In order to drive Strahd back, they also have a weekly festival with mandatory attendance. Everyone has to be happy and cheering, and sadness is outlawed. While everyone's secretly miserable, the Burgomaster believes that the weekly festivals and revelry will keep the devil at bay. They're very proud of the fact that Strahd hasn't set foot in Vallaki in over 100 years. We also meet up with a carnival owner, Rictavio.
Oh, you're newcomers as well? I just arrived 2 months ago. I have a traveling circus that I've been going around with. Not many customers, I'm afraid. Very dangerous place here, isn't it? Can never be too careful. If you have any questions, please talk to me, Rictavio.
At first, we're really skeptical of him. I mean, rightly so. But he's extremely helpful and gives us a massive info dump about the lands and what cities are where and who runs what. After everything, we finally manage to go to bed. Irina goes upstairs, passing Rictavio, who stares at her, eyes wide, saying under his breath,
"Is she... no. The Curse of Strahd?" "What?" "Oh, nothing," Rictavio said, shaking his head. "I was just thinking to myself of a funny joke."
And he quickly left the Blue Water Inn. The rest of the group was able to hunker down for the night. And as we lay in bed in this strange, morbid, curious town waiting for the new day, that was where our session ended.